is a story about control. My control. Control of what I say and control of what I do. And this time I'm gonna do it my way. I hope you enjoy this as much as I do. Are we ready? I am.
The wait is over. It's finally here. Season 4 of The Family Business on BET Plus. Watch it tonight. I will be watching. See you there.
Happy Monday, friends. So I hope your day is getting off to a great start so far. We've got a beautiful day today. The sun is shining. It's nice and warm outside. So I encourage you to get outside, soak up all that vitamin D, maybe take your yoga practice outside. If you need a pose to do today, we're gonna be working on tight hips, which is something that I always get told that I have. I don't know why, but I think it's something that a lot of us experience. So today we're going to do a pose called double pigeon pose, which is really good for opening your hips, and it has a lot of other really good benefits. All right, for this pose, you can start sitting and then start to bend your knees, bringing your left right under your left knee or your right knee, and then bending your right foot and bringing your right ankle on top of your left knee here. Now you want to keep your hips squared with the outer edges of your mat, and then you can just rest your hands here. This is a little bit of an intense pose, so any time you need to get out of it, go ahead and do that. If this feels good for you, you can stay right here. Otherwise, you can stretch your hands out in front of you and start to walk your torso to the floor for a deeper stretch. And you just hold here for a couple of breaths.
I literally feel naked without my keys. You know, this is better than gold. This is gold. I don't care what nobody say. You can't tell me this is not a platinum diamond chain. Because you know what? I walked right through those doors and I got sober. I've connected with my siblings. I have connected with my children. I have mentally and emotionally connected back with myself, which is very important. Home is everything.
She is the mother I never had. She is the sister everybody would want. She is the friend that everybody deserves. I don't know a better person. I don't know a better person.
Shout out to Paramount Global, where we work every morning. So when I come in the morning, this is how we're greeted. I love this. Christmas decorations up. I love everybody's represented. Are you coming with me, Allison?
I'm coming.
Kwanzaa, the menorah, beautiful tree. But this is what I really like over here, Allison. Be happy, be bright, be you. Isn't that a good way to start the day? Be happy, be bright, be you. Do with that what you will. Thank you, Paramount. Thank you.
This morning.
He has something he wants to say about school shootings. Here is his extra point.
Another high school shooting yesterday, this one in Florida. 17 dead, the last report I saw. And everybody sends their thoughts and prayers again because that works so well. This is the 18th high school shooting in America this year, and we have 10 and a half months to go. We've had 290 since 2013. We average about one a week, but there's just nothing we can do. If it was a Muslim or a Mexican doing the shooting, how many new laws and how much money would we spend then to stop the madness? But since it's almost always a white kid, there's just nothing we can do. America has 5% of the world's population, and yet 31% of the world's mass shootings. We're worried about people coming to this country. They should be worried about us going to theirs. Australia had 4 mass shootings between 87 and 96. They passed stricter gun laws and haven't had a single mass shooting since. And here I thought, guns don't kill, people do. Is this the people we are? Last time I said we need to find a way to stop a nut with a gun, and that's all I said, I get an email saying, I'm saving my last bullet to put it right between your eyes. Just another responsible gun owner in America, and I'm taking all bets he's a white guy. So there's just nothing we can do. I'm Dale Hansen. It's getting harder to enjoy the...
Former President Trump still faces other criminal investigations in addition to this hush money case we've been talking about all morning, including a special counsel's inquiry into the January 6th assault on the Capitol and his handling of documents that were marked classified that were found at his Florida home. The district attorney in Atlanta, as you've heard, is also weighing charges in Trump's effort to interfere in the 2020 vote count in Georgia. Let's focus now on what will happen here in New York City next week. Tuesday, they say, is the day. Attorney Joe Tacopina is defending the former president in the Manhattan DA's case. It's good to see you again, Mr. Tacopina. Let's start right away with this question. When did you and the president find out about this indictment? We were all led to believe that it was going to be delayed sometime.
Yeah, we were led to believe the same thing, Gail. I mean, it was yesterday at around 5:30 in the afternoon, much later in the day than normal, but that's when we learned.
Have you had a chance to look at the indictment? I know it's sealed. Have you had a chance to see it?
We've not. People are reporting how many counts are and whatnot. It's all, news to us. I mean, we've unfortunately gotten a lot of our information in this saga through media reports. We've not seen it. When it's unsealed, we will take a look at it.
Well, if you haven't seen it, how can you and your team say that it's a political witch hunt, that it's politically motivated, if we don't really know exactly what's in it yet?
No, I know what's in it. What I don't know is the number of counts and what the counts are premised on, but I do know the subject matter of the indictment. They've made that clear to us. It's about a civil confidentiality agreement executed by President Trump's ex-lawyer, a lawyer for Stormy Daniels, and nothing more. So we know it's premised and based on that fact pattern, which doesn't equate to a crime, not even close to a crime. If you want to look at campaign finance laws and discuss that, FEC chairmen have come on and said there is no crime here. The FEC looked at this and found no wrongdoing whatsoever. We know what the subject matter is. We know the basis of the charges. We don't know the exact counts or how they're formulating the counts, but that doesn't really matter.
Well, based on your statement that you made just now, how worried is Donald Trump about this indictment?
Oh, he's not worried at all. I mean, he's upset, angry. He is being persecuted politically. That is clear to many people, not only on the right, but on the left. And we as Americans, honestly, should be concerned. Today it's Donald Trump. Tomorrow it's going to be a Democrat. The day after that, it could be your brother, your son, your daughter. And we have to be concerned about the rule of law falling. Because what's happened here is this is a case that would not have been brought against another individual in this country if his name wasn't Donald Trump. Pursued by a prosecutor who has obviously very diverse political views from the president. So it's a very troubling case because there's no crime here. The United States Attorney's Office, who has jurisdiction over federal election campaigns, turned this down. The FEC, the Federal Election Committee, turned this down and said there was no wrongdoing. So how a state prosecutor is going to prosecute a federal election campaign violation, which they think is a violation, which clearly isn't if you understand the law,
I really have no idea. I hear you, but we just had Senator Warren here. Many Democrats are saying the same thing. Nobody is above the law. Let's let the process play out. Why don't we all just take that process? Go ahead.
Yeah, I agree with you. No one's above the law.
Just let the process play out.
Could not agree with you more. But no one's below the law either, right? And we shouldn't pick the person and then try to find the crime. And if you read that prosecutor's book, Mark Pomerantz, who left the office in a huff and wrote a book, what he said was they had Donald Trump, they despised and loathed him, and he was looking for a crime to fit the person. That's Nazi Germany era. That's communist China, Soviet Union. We do not do that in this country. We don't go after people we don't like and try to find a crime. And that's what happened here.
All right. Can you just tell us briefly the process on Tuesday? What will happen? Will Donald Trump show up in New York? Will he be walked in the front of the, right in the front doors of the court case in 20 seconds?
Yeah, we're trying to work out those logistics. It looks like possibly Tuesday, but I don't know yet. And as far as how that all happens, this is a case of first impression for all of us. You have Secret Service involved, yes. NYPD, Court Officers Union. So I'm not sure exactly how it plays out, but we'll get through it.
We will get through it, and we will be there. Thank you very much for your time this morning.
Happy Monday, friends. So I have been taking a well-needed break from social media, which I think is really beneficial for a lot of us to do at times. I really wanted to do it the week leading up to my birthday, especially because I wanted to spend coming into that new chapter of my life in the present moment, not on a phone, not on a screen. But I am back, and today we're going to do a pose called Frog Pose, which is a really good pose for coming into the present moment and relaxation. Also a really deep hip opening pose, which is always good. So it's gonna help with mobility in your hips. Also really good for circulation. And then lastly, of course, managing stress and anxiety. For this pose, you wanna start in your tabletop position. From here, start to widen your knees. And you wanna turn your toes out to either side of you. Now from here, you can come down to your forearms. And depending on your flexibility, you can widen your knees as much as feels comfortable to you and bring your hands together here. You can stay here and just breathe if it feels good for you. Otherwise, you can extend your arms out, bringing your forehead to the ground, or even resting on a pillow.
We're going to begin this hour with a look at the audio streaming giant Spotify, which for millions of users has got a very different look this morning. The company rolled out the biggest changes to its platform since it launched on cell phones, more than a decade ago. Spotify was founded back in 2006 as a way to try to solve the music piracy problem. And now, almost 17 years later, it is a one-stop shop for music, for podcasts, and don't forget those audiobooks. In a CBS Mornings exclusive, we like when that happens, we met up with the co-founder and CEO. His name is Daniel Ek. He's a Swedish entrepreneur who you don't hear from much. We caught up with him a couple of days ago at Spotify's LA campus to talk about the company's future.
When I started Spotify, my dream was to be able to combine my two big loves, which is technology and computers on the one hand and music.
Spotify CEO and founder Daniel Ek has done just that and so much more in music streaming to the unparalleled tune of 500 million users. And on Wednesday, Spotify debuted an entirely new home feed where users are able to scroll and see content tailored to their interest. Did you make the scrolling and the videos because of TikTok? Were you looking at TikTok going, we got to do something about this?
Well,
we've got to change with the program. Was that part of it?
Well, it wasn't so much around a specific sort of platform. You have to live in the future. And for me, the future is always the young people. What are they doing in various cultures? And I would say as an industry, every few years, someone brings something out from a design perspective that's just much, much better way for people to interact with it. And, you know, Snap, for instance, did that with stories, and now almost every platform has stories. And TikTok obviously did that with the discovery feed as well. So we're definitely taking inspiration from that, but we're adding a unique Spotify twist on it too. So I don't want people to think that we're making this to be like TikTok. We're making it to be a much more interactive Spotify.
Another new feature, Spotify's AI DJ.
What's going on? I'm X, and from this moment on, I'm going to be your own personal AI DJ on Spotify.
What it really is imagine having like your own personal DJ that knows your music taste, knows what kind of music you're liking, and is able to give you context around why you're hearing that songs and putting together the perfect sort of music
for
the right moment.
AI DJ does not sound like a robot.
it sounds like a real person.
Yes.
Did you do that on purpose?
Yes, we did. We did that on purpose. And in fact, it's actually a real person too.
Hi.
How are you?
I know X.
You know me?
Yes, because you're on my phone.
Yes, I am.
You're on my phone.
You like it? You enjoying it?
I think it's so cool. Your thing is so conversational. That's the thing. It's like you're just, like you know me. And I think that's the whole point.
That is the point.
It's about real connection.
Yes.
We want to make real connections. We bring new music suggestions for you. So it's not just music that you already listen to.
Yeah.
You know, so we're going to give you something that we think you'll like based on what you already like.
Yeah, I like
and in that way, with that context, you're likely to check it out. And that helps artists because their biggest problem is discoverability. So this is helping artists connect with fans, and then everybody wins in that situation.
We kept touring Spotify's Los Angeles campus.
So now we're at Pod City. So
Pod
this
City.
Is our kind of main podcast studio. More and more of our studios now, as we're having more and more video as well, are having kind of video all around them too.
Daniel, you just said this is your favorite space.
Yeah.
Why? This is very cool. Why?
Probably out of all of our offices. This is our music recording studio where, for instance, we record Spotify singles, which is a concept now that generated over billions of streams.
Hi, we're the Jonas Brothers, and we are so excited to be here with you today.
At Wednesday's big event to announce changes to the platform, the Jonas Brothers introduced countdown pages for new releases.
We're an experience that's focused on deep engagement and listening, but also a very big part of what we're focusing on as well is for people who aspire to be professional or are already professional. So we're not the place perhaps where you connect with friends or express you know, a funny video, but we are a place where you can share your art, you can engage with fans, and you can monetize that art better.
Spotify says it is the music industry's number one revenue generator, paying out more than $40 billion with a B. After years of criticism about how artists are paid through streaming, in 2021, the company created a website called Loud and Clear to clarify exactly who receives those payments.
Many people still think Spotify doesn't pay the artists. Who should they direct their inquiries to, if not to you at Spotify?
Yeah, well, technically it is true that we don't pay artists directly. So what we do is we pay all the rights holders. So we pay the record labels. Yeah,
yes.
Record labels, but also the music publishers. So sometimes when I sit down with artists and they sort of tell me
I didn't get paid.
As an example, it's very hard because they have their deals with their record companies and their deals with their publishers, et cetera. And what Spotify does is we pay out to those record companies and these publishers and don't know what individual deals these artists may have. So it's a complex topic, but I wish I would have handled it upfront. And it's very hard to change a narrative once that narrative has established itself. That's, I guess, the lesson learned from my side.
Another complex topic for Eck, content moderation. Spotify is home to the number one podcast in the world, The Joe Rogan Experience. Joe Rogan has been a source of controversy for the company. Just last month, he made a comment perpetuating an anti-Semitic stereotype. In response, the CEO of the Anti-Defamation League said this, "Disturbing that at a time of rising anti-Jewish violence, Joe Rogan would use his immense platform to spew anti-Semitic tropes about Jews and money." The episode is still up on Spotify.
We have these guidelines where if people are, you know, subjecting other people to harm, we do take action. But I think it is important that we are a place that allows a lot of diverse voices to be able to express themselves, to be able to communicate through art.
Do you consider some of the things he says to be anti-Semitic? And if so, how do you reconcile that on your platform?
Yeah, I would say I find that comment in particular highly offensive. And there are a lot of things that I disagree with that Joe Rogan and lots of other voices are saying on our platform as well. But I come back to it, is this violating our terms of service or not? And if it is, then we take it down. And if you take anti-Semitic comments, we've taken down thousands of podcasts that have violated our our platform rules, and in the broader context, there's probably hundreds of thousands of episodes that are violating other terms of service as well. Mm-hmm. So we do take that very seriously.
Eck also says he does not decide what gets removed from Spotify himself.
We have experts and a safety advisory council that take those actions. So it's not me personally that takes those actions.
But because you're the face, Daniel, no one says, you know, the experts say it's directly attributed to you. That's the thinking in the public eye.
And I understand that. But I think it's really important that this isn't just a decision that's made by me. It is made by a diverse group of people, too, with a varied perspective. And the same rules apply to Joe Rogan as it would to any other podcaster. Mm-hmm.
It's reported that his contract is up at the end of this year. Will he be renewed?
Well, what I can say is the contract, I believe, has some more time to go than that. So we'll cross that bridge when we get to it.
After 17 years at the helm of Spotify, Eck is reflecting on his journey.
I don't know of a single entrepreneur that if you would go back to them now and ask them, if you knew everything you know now, would you do it again? And the answer, certainly for me, but I think for unilaterally for all the entrepreneurs I've been talking to, has been like, no, because it's so hard. It's such an emotional roller coaster.
You wouldn't do it again? This way?
No, I'm not sure, to be honest.
Really?
It's not because it's not been worth it. It's been the most gratifying thing I've ever done in my life, besides my kids. But
and your wife.
And my wife,
she's
of course.
She's lovely.
Yes. But it's not for the faint-hearted.
Not for the faint-hearted. Mm, wow. Just think, he launched his company when he was 22. Mm. He just turned 40 recently. He says that he's his own worst critic. He said people that work with him say that he's very tough on himself and he's never satisfied. And he sees that as a blessing and a curse. Yeah. And at 40, what are his new dreams? He said, I'm just trying to make this better.
I'm intrigued by his last answer to you, though.
Oh, yeah. I was, too. Right? I was actually very surprised at that he doesn't think that he would do this again.
Little window
this is very hard.
How difficult it is. Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, you asked him some tough questions as well. I like the point about making money that he brought up earlier, which is, you know, we're not losing money, we're investing money.
Yeah.
I mean, we intend to keep growing.
That was deliberate. Yeah. I hadn't thought about that. I hadn't thought about it from that way. Well, I know people will still be upset about his answer about Joe Rogan.
Yeah.
He says it's not me, it's a group of people, although he has a lot of power there. He could make the decision, but he's relying on a team of experts to tell him and guide him along about what's the best thing to do here.
Waiting for my update.
Well, I'll show you how to get to it.
Yeah,
I got it.
Back to life, back to reality. Back to life, back to reality.
Whatever they want. Supposed to chew with your mouth full, but this is delicious.
Okay. What I really love about Shake Shack is that the bread is always soft, and it just like makes the perfect burger because you're not like biting your bread to get to your burger.
Okay.
Ooh, that's loud. But that's nice.
Truff. All right, we are revisiting Blair Social Second, 6:54 right now. Of course, April Fool's Day is tomorrow. We ask you what are the best jokes or pranks that you've seen play out. Funny stuff there in those comments, guys. You got to go check it out to get some ideas. Christy, good morning to you, Christy. She said, Redbox posted they were playing a movie in the parking lot of Walgreens and to bring your lawn chairs. They even had a photo with people sitting in lawn chairs circled around Redbox watching that little screen. I thought, what? Then it came to me, April Fool's. Then we heard from Laura. She said, my aunt and uncle got married on April Fool's. So if anything ever happened, they could just say it was a joke. Then we heard from Debbie McKinney. Debbie really went in with her April Fool. She says, I put a Corvette, incredibly cheap, for sale in the newspaper and put my friend's number on there, and he got hundreds of calls. I also got a realtor sign from another friend and put them in the yard, and everybody thought his house was for sale. I made fake brownies. Here's how she did it. She soaked sponges in cocoa powder water, frosted them, put chocolate frosting and sprinkles on top, put them in a bakery box, and then took them to her grandkids. So sponges with chocolate on top. She said it was great. Want to hear about you guys if you get into the spirit of April Fool's. You like to, you know, joke around. You know, ideas from you guys. Go to our Facebook page, Fox 2 Now, and put them on there for us.
Good Sunday morning, friends, and welcome back. So today we're talking tight hips, which is something that I think a lot of us can say we deal with. So this week and next week, we're going to do a couple poses that are really good for opening, for stretching your hips. Today's one is going to be called recline pigeon pose. And this is a really good one, like I said, for opening, stretching your hips, which is a place where we hold a lot of that negative pent up energy. So really good for releasing that. Also really good for stretching your glutes and your hamstrings. This one is really good for promoting relaxation and blood flow, so circulation as well. All right, go ahead and grab your mat and let's get started. So for this pose, we're gonna come down all the way to our mats, come to sitting, and we're gonna roll down to our back here. Now from here, we're gonna lift and bend our right foot, putting it on our left knee. And then from here, start to lift your left leg up and clasping your hands behind your left hamstring. Now you can stay here, or for a deeper stretch, you can start to pull your knee towards your face. And you just hold here for a couple breaths. And to come out of this pose, you can go ahead and release your hands, bringing your foot back down to the mat, dropping your right foot to meet your left, and then rolling back up to come to a seated position. And that is this week's Tranquil Time with Taylor. As always, the light and love in me sees and honors the light and love in each and every one of you. I will see you guys next week for next week's pose.
Fucked up too is when you talk proudly about black women, everyone gets upset. Everyone gets mad. Because the hatred of black people is so ingrained that if I go, black women are amazing. Well, you're being racist. What the fuck? Does that even make any sense? That doesn't even make any sense. Black women are the shit. They age the best. They got the best bodies. You motherfuckers age early. Fuck you. You feel me? And you copy everything from black women. You dance like them. You talk like them. You ever see other races when girls want to get an attitude? They do this shit. They go, let me. I see Asian girls doing this. I see Latin girls. It's black women shit. Right? Yeah. You get everything from black women. Even gay white men steal shit from black women. Girl, honey. The fuck out of here. Black women are the trend.
You know, I was wondering, you know, if you could keep on, because the force, it's got a lot of power, and it makes me feel like, it makes me feel like, oh.
soul. I'm not your enemy.
I want to talk to you.
I know who the enemy is.
I want to talk.
You're wasting your time making mockery of me. I'm crazy. My brain is damaged. My Envo poster. I'm miserable in my life. All this nonsense that you talk about. And you a slave, just like me, in a racist nation.
I believe that if you find a sign, together we can touch the skies.
Something about the period that I'm sort of in love with, and I'm not really happy to see leave, to like go back to like a very contemporary. It's very nice to see, like, you know, Chad be Jackie and be such a gentleman, and all the extras and the ladies dressed the way that they are, and, you know, the poise of the period and the music. It's almost like you're in this world, and then you go off, you get in your van, you go home, and like suddenly people are in skin tight jeans again, and it's like, you know, loud music blaring. There's something about that that I'm gonna miss. Well, Jackie needed someone, and I think Rachel traveled with the team because there was no one there for Jack as a companion. Rachel was the only one, and vice versa. There was no one there for her as well. So they were together on this mission with Branch, you know, as well. But they were together day and night and dealing with the bruises, the physical and otherwise. I think one of the things also about their relationship that struck me was that they found a way of coping with some of the hardships that they had to deal with by finding the humor with one another and spending time with one another. It's sort of like taking drives around and things like that. And I was like, wow, it seems like such a tiny, small little thing, but it actually helped them get through years and years of sort of isolated lifestyle. I think Jackie Robinson, he did so much touring and playing with the Negro Leagues and he had other experiences with the hostility that can come from racism. Rachel, on the other hand, lived in California and went to school, and she was just sort of from a different walk of life. And they're very loyal and passionate, but they were from two different camps in a way. And I think it was a rude awakening for her to be on the road. And when they got married, I think the expectation from what she said to me and from what Brian's written and from what we're sort of trying to collectively tell as a story is that, like, she was expecting a honeymoon, sort of like we're going to, you know, to be these pioneers, and it ended up being a more humbling and compromising situation. He's got determination, focus, vulnerability, got all the good stuff, and they've been working him hard. I mean, he's been working so hard. Like, all these different cameras going, and it's amazing. Yeah, he has that sort of the unstoppable thing that kind of has you in wonder. I'm like, how does this guy keep going?
We're going to begin this hour with the third part of our series that we call Facing Fertility. This morning, we are focusing on menopause. That's the end of fertility for women. And now more than ever, women, including big names like Michelle Obama, Naomi Watts, and others, they're coming forward to say, we got to talk about this. Most women start menopause around the ages of, say, 51, 52. 5% of women experience early menopause. That means between the ages of 40 and 45. And 1% experience it even before the age of 40. So talking about menopause, we know this isn't always comfortable, but it's so very, very important. That's why Drew Barrymore and I said yes when Nikki Batiste asked us, let's sit down and have a conversation. We started that conversation with perimenopause. That's when many women start to notice changes as the body starts transitioning toward the M word, menopause.
Was there an aha moment where you thought, I'm in perimenopause?
I realized that I was in perimenopause when I started having my period every 2 weeks. And then that...
Wasn't it a heavy flow? That's a sign.
Yes, like a teenager. Well, one doctor also just told me, like, this could last, you know, on the worst case scenario, 10 years. And I was like, I will never make it 10 years like this.
Well, I did.
Well, help me.
I did.
You know, how another thing you're going to help
and
me through,
true.
Gail.
It can last 10 years. I mean, the perimenopause doesn't last 10 years, but I still have, you know, they say by the time you're 50, definitely there's something going on. I'm just glad we're even having this conversation, Nikki, because I didn't even know the phrase perimenopause.
Same.
I had never even heard, I'd heard of menopause, but I'd never even heard the phrase perimenopause until I went to the doctor because, you know, not to get too graphic, but when it first happens for a lot of people, it looked like a crime scene.
Since you've been through the whole process.
But I still, I don't think I'm done because I still have hot flashes.
You still do?
I still do. Not as much as I used to. Not as much as I used to. A couple times during COVID, I'm like, is this COVID or is this menopause?
What does a hot flash feel like? Because that I'm not getting yet.
Feels like, it starts with, it feels like you're burning inside. And then...
Like acid reflux?
No, it just feels hot.
Okay.
For me, it was just a physical heat. And then you can sometimes have dripping, drenching sweats. It just can happen at the most inopportune times. I've been on the red carpet where a photographer say, Gail, are you okay? I go, it's just a hot flash. And they go, oh, sorry. It's like people when you say, I'm having hot, oh, sorry. Like they've said something very bad about you.
But
that's why I think it's good we're saying, yes, menopause,
know.
Hot flashes, dry vagina. It's all part of it.
Most people just hear menopause and think, it's hot flashes. That's all it is. But it's so much more.
Why has hot flashes been marketed so well where people go, oh, sure. Yeah. But if you say perimenopause, I'm in menopause, you know, I'm experiencing this. Most of it seems very unfamiliar and confusing, mm-hmm. not mm-hmm. just to men, but women. Mm-hmm.
Did either of you seek any treatment? Go talk to a doctor.
I did talk to a doctor, but I didn't take any hormones. You know, I know friends that have creams or they take medication, and I've just sort of weathered through it when I realized you really don't have to do that.
I was offered hormone therapy, and I said no.
Why?
Because I really didn't feel like the doctor who was suggesting it understood where I was at. And it seemed preemptive. And I'm like, until I get so desperate, and this is all so obvious, I don't want to take something preemptively. At some point, there might be a treatment that's right for you. So don't do it too fast, but don't be a hero unnecessarily if you don't need to be.
Yeah, don't be a hero. The other reason why I think this is hard is because when you think of menopause, you think of old.
Yeah.
You think of old, her life is over, she's done.
Put her out to pasture.
Yes, and what we know is that's just not true. That if there's any message we could get across, I think that would be the one that would be the most helpful.
How do we change the conversation about menopause to be
this
humorous?
Keep talking, because it is kind of funny.
The crime scene.
Everything is kind of funny. I think the more women also, you know, in their 40s, 50s, and 60s mm-hmm. are looking so attractive, feeling so vibrant, living their best lives. The way menopause has been branded is you're old, you're done. Mm-hmm. That's not it.
Yeah. You're old, you're done. Your vagina is dry.
Yeah.
You have no value in society anymore.
You're not attractive.
Like, you're not attractive. It's like cobwebs down there.
Yeah. I mean, you're not sexy.
And all that's not true. Also, the other thing, Nikki, is you don't have to have drastic symptoms. not everybody has these kind of symptoms. I know some women who they've been through it and they've just sort of sailed through it, have had very minimal things. It wasn't disruptive to their life. That was not my experience. But my mother also had very bad symptoms, but she never talked about it. Listen, I remember being on vacation with my mom and she had white pants and her period came on. She was in menopause, it had to be perimenopause. And this blood started gushing. I said, what is happening? She goes, oh, nothing. I'm fine. No conversation about it.
Why is that? Why has that been the way for so long?
Yes.
Even our own moms.
Yes, because they were embarrassed. And it was in...
A generational thing.
It was generational, and it was improper and indelicate to talk about. You're not raising Frankie and Olive that way, I'm sure. Yeah.
I think we should educate ourselves, too.
I
have to tell the guys.
Bo's mom. I was just going to say that. I think you have to have a conversation with your boys as well. But I do think kids, boys and girls, should be well-informed. I don't want little boys going, ew, I don't want that.
Because
it is something that we go through. And it's just, you know, male and female, there are differences, and those differences are okay.
If you were to use one word, one phrase to describe how we should think about menopause, what would it be?
One word. Reality.
Mine's natural.
Ah, that's good.
I think ours are really, as usual, hand in hand.
That's good.
Yeah,
reality.
An OBGYN who specializes in menopause told me that hormone replacement therapy can be safe and effective if it's done at the right age for the right amount of time. What that time frame is can vary from woman to woman. Another doctor told us that women who reach menopause before 45, especially before 40, should strongly consider hormone replacement therapy.
Yeah, all the doctors will tell you that it is safe. We did something with Dr. Sharon Malone at Oprah Daily. She says we need to stop normalizing. She's also a doctor who specializes in this. Stop normalizing suffering around this. You know, it seems such a taboo and uncomfortable thing. But I think Michelle Obama says it best. She says, you know, when you reach menopause, be glad that you've reached it. It just shows you're at another stage of life. Mm-hmm. She says, there's no shame in my menopause game. And I think we have to figure out a better way to reframe the conversation so it doesn't make people uncomfortable, including men.
Yeah. I think
including little boys.
That's a great point, Gail, because throughout this conversation that you were having, I think Tony and I were, we kept asking questions. I'm stunned at my own ignorance when it comes to this particular subject. I'm actually stunned, and I consider myself somebody who kind of knows a lot of things about a lot of things, and I don't know anything as much as I should about this. And I have a little girl at home.
Understanding is being able to make us feel more comfortable. And I think for me, I always worried, will I be less desirable? Will I be less sexy when I hit menopause? But Gail King, you're living proof that
that's not the case. No, and the answer is no.
Yes.
The answer really is no. I mean, there's just so much stuff that happens to a woman's body. You guys are so lucky in that respect. We have so many moving parts and so much stuff that happens. I don't feel you guys have to go through half the stuff we
it's
do.
It's not a competition.
Gail, I want to thank you and Drew for your transparency and having this conversation.
It helped so many others. Vicky, yeah.
I also want to thank our Facing Fertility series producers, Hillary Cook and Rachel Bailey,
yes,
and editor Chris Hassan. They've been wonderful. And a personal thanks to my fertility doctor, Dr. Eric Foreman, at Columbia University Fertility Center.
Such an important series. I'm really proud of you and our show for doing this.
Me too. But Nikki guided us through it, you know, because Drew and I could both be long talkers. Nikki has a tendency, let's get back on track, girls, is what we're talking about.
I learned so much. Thank you.
Well done. Natural and reality. Those are the two words. All right, Nikki, thank you very much.
Where my crazy nieces at? Oh, they go one of them. They go... We had a nice day. Angel Snow No 7 in the house with the nieces of reality. Say hi to my audience real quick. Now they done got all big since the last time y'all seen them.
Hey.
This is Sister J. And this is Sister, what was your Sister D? That's Sister D, Sister J. We had a nice time today.
DJ.
Oh my
God. Hey, y'all.
Yeah, we went out there.
Anybody even watch it?
Took them.
Why you about that later?
Yeah, came on. We went out there, gave them a few driver lessons, set them up so they can get their driver license.
Oh, I was the best.
And
I got a
see, look, it said nieces of reality. See,
is that
know who you are.
Is that Among Us characters?
Huh?
What are those?
Train, Soul Train. Oh. We represent the Soul Train. Anyway, say hi to the audience real quick, y'all.
Hi.
This is Sister D.
Hey, y'all.
Sister D, She's big now. Sister J, okay. They big. Doing our thing. Hope y'all have a nice night. We'll check y'all out on the flip. Peace!
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 So embarrassing. Why do you take so long to end it? End it.
I can't end it. All right.
Revisiting Blair Social Second, Blockbuster has a website. They've been hitting around that they might be coming back, you know? So they had some people speculating. I asked you all, would you support the return of Blockbuster in DVDs? You still got some laying around? Jeff O'Connor said, not with that same model. Mm-mm. Why would I pay to rent a physical movie that plays on devices I don't have anymore when I can rent any movie I want on Amazon or Apple or whatever service? Then have to drive to return it? I love nostalgia as much as the next person, but they need a different business model. Okay, we hear that. Then we heard from Jim. Good morning to you, Jim. He said, yes, because I absolutely loved running up there after a new release, only to find they didn't have it behind any of the 30 VHS boxes. Love that. Angela mentioned that that was something that would happen quite often, giving us a little sarcasm. We like to get that on the morning show. There we go. Brenda, oh, I would go and prefer it. They used to have a fabulous old movie section. I just can't find those anymore. So Brenda would be going there to get those old movies and to enjoy those. So a lot of people are on both sides. Some people saying they just like the convenience of what we got now. So go to our Facebook page, chime in, and let us know what you think about going down memory lane and getting some DVDs again. All right, guys, Albert Pujols, Yadier Molina won't be on the diamond this time around. The roster looks different. We asked you guys, what are you excited to see on the diamond this season with some of the new players out? We heard from a few of you guys. Kevin File, good morning to you. Kevin, he said, probably Gorman and Walker. Having them with Nolan and Goldie could be amazing. Then throwing in Wilson, it could be a dynamic lineup. And then we also heard from Luke Wildhaber. Good morning to you, Luke. He simply said, Jordan Walker. Whole lot of exclamation marks. We're excited to see him. And as you saw him there, pretty humble guy. He said he doesn't like to hear too much about himself. He's just ready to get this game going. And he does have some opening day butterflies. And then lastly, we heard from Cameron Middleton. He said, I'm excited to see how well Wilson Contreras will perform. So definitely some new stuff to look out for on this opening day and throughout the rest of the season. So I want to continue to hear from you guys. Go to our Facebook page, Fox 2 Now. All right, we are revisiting Blair Social Second. There's a thing out there called Bare Minimum Mondays, right? So I asked you all, if you take it easy at work on Mondays to recuperate from the weekend, because apparently a lot of people are doing this. So we heard from a few of you. Joyce Crest, she said, I do Bare Minimum Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, but I'm retired. Unless I'm needed to do something with the grandkids, then I'm ready to go. So it's okay for her to do the bare minimum on a Monday. She's put her work in over the years. Then we heard from Melissa. Good morning to you, Melissa. She said, I work in a doctor's office. Mondays are always the busiest days of the week. Of course I don't believe in bare minimum. I work hard every day. We got a lot of responses like that, too. I like this one here. Douglas Thurman, good morning to you. Good morning to you, Douglas. He said, I give him 100% every week. 20% every day. All right. Like to hear that, Douglas. We're going to go to break right now. Stick with us. It is 6:55, 31 degrees on this Monday morning.
We're going to begin this hour with our exclusive interview with movie and TV superstar. That would be Angela Bassett. Wow. You know her from American Horror Story, How Stella Got Her Groove Back. Love that movie. And her first Oscar-nominated role as Tina Turner in What's Love Got to Do With It? Do With It. Now, nearly 30 years later, Bassett is a nominee again. She is up for Best Supporting Actress for her performance as Queen Ramonda in Black Panther Wakanda Forever. We met in Los Angeles recently, and we asked her to reflect on this very special moment in her life and her brilliant career. Do you remember the first time that you performed in front of an audience? Because right now you are Angela Bassett, exclamation point, capital letters. Do you remember when you were Angela Bassett and the first time you performed on stage, and you performed in front of an audience?
What it was, Madam and the Reverend. Reverend came by my house last week. He said, Sister, have you a little time to speak? He said, I'm interested in your soul. Has it been saved or is your heart stone cold? I said, Reverend, I'll have you know, I was baptized long ago. He said, Sister, what have you done since then? I said, none of your business, friend. Well, I felt kind of bad. I talked that way after the Reverend went away, so I ain't in no mood for sin today.
Angela, how do you do that all these years later? Oh. How do you do that?
That's so good. That one was fun. I don't know. Some things just stay with you.
They just stay
you
with
know,
you.
Like an old song.
And Angela Bassett has done quite a bit since her early theater days.
Don't start with me. I ain't in the mood today, all right?
From film to TV.
The next needle I use will put a hole in your heart.
To her Academy Award-nominated role in Wakanda Forever.
Your brother is with the ancestors.
When the nominations came out, you were one of the few people that said, I actually got up to watch. I asked Courtney, my husband, let's get up and watch it. Because so many people say, oh, I was asleep, I didn't know, my phone started blowing up. You actually said, no, I got up to watch the Oscar nominations come in.
I mean, so excited that I woke up at 3:45. I did not plan to do that. I set my alarm for 5:25, yeah. Just 5 minutes before. Sleep as long as I could.
And so when they called the name.
Angela Bassett in Black Panther, Wakanda Forever.
I think I yelped and then I went sotto voce, like, oh. Uh-huh.
What does this role and this movie mean to you?
Queen Ramonda for me is just, you know, at its core, representation of the strong women that I've had in my life who've raised me, of the strong women I see, my love for them, my appreciation of them.
Spoiler alert, by now everyone has seen this movie. When you read the script and found that she was not going to survive, what did you think? Mm. When I was sitting in my seat, I couldn't believe it. I said, I know she's coming back. Right. I know this must be a dream. Right. That was such a shock.
Oh my God, I was hit just as hard. You know, I'm, you know, at home reading the script. I'm so happy we're going to do, you know, Wakanda. We're going to do a second one because, yes. I mean, how are we going to do it when we've lost our king, you know? But there was a way made, and here I am sitting, reading the script, you know, enthused, happy, ecstatic, turn the page, and I see this, and I'm like, Courtney!
You called Courtney?
Courtney! Oh, my God.
So you were just as surprised as we were sitting in our seats.
I absolutely was. I was like, Ryan, please, really? Do you have to? You know, I mean, yes. I really respect my director
and
his vision.
I
knew I couldn't live if I didn't say, just really, Ryan.
I feel okay talking about it now because it's known. But I really appreciate no one spoiled it for others, even walking out of the theater.
I remember at the premiere, it was just so quiet around and people were literally, you know, weeping You thought, oh my gosh, that a movie can do this. And that's that feeling I had at 15, sitting in the theater, watching Of Mice and Men, weeping that a movie, cinema, a performances can so move us.
What's that like for you to be able to deliver that feeling to others?
Oh, it's a dream come true.
It's been 29 years since Bassett's last Oscar nomination.
Left a good job down in the city.
For her portrayal of Tina Turner in What's Love Got to Do with It.
Is there a big difference between the nomination then and the nomination now?
The nomination now, it seems a lot busier. You know, I was green. I was in my salad days, as Shakespeare would say. Yeah, when I was green.
We wanted to take a trip a little further down memory lane.
Hopefully you'll recognize this.
Okay.
Oh, look at that. This is, Angela, this is the actual dress.
In What's Love Got to Do
yes.
with It? Proud Mary.
Do you remember that? You still remember that?
We would do take. We did that song all day, and we do it from the top of the song to the end of the song, completely through, not like bits and pieces. Yeah. The entire thing, me and the girls, the Iquettes, and afterwards, as if you swallowed a wool sweater, and he would say, go again! And he was like, can an actor have a moment, a minute?
This is one of the few things that they kept in the archives from the movie, is this dress. When was the last time you saw it? Do you even remember?
That day. Last day of shooting.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm.
I love it. I love it. Can I take it home? I'll keep it safe.
There are many people who believed you were robbed of the Oscar that night at the award show. Do you feel that way when you look back years later? Where does that sit with you?
Oh, of course. And, you know, in the moment, you're hoping and praying and wishing. But I don't walk away thinking I've been robbed. That's too negative of an emotion to carry with me, you know, for the rest of my life. I choose to believe that there's a reason why it didn't happen.
Bassett's next role wouldn't come for 18 months.
It was Strange Days, it was Vampire in Brooklyn, and it was Waiting to Exhale.
Started that damn company without me. Hell, I worked my ass off.
Angela, I had a Waiting to Exhale party.
You did?
Yeah, this was before we even knew the phrase Black Girl Magic. But it was a group of black women gathered around to watch that movie. And there was always something that everybody could relate to when you're watching. I loved Waiting to Exhale.
Thank you.
Where does that sit with you, Waiting to Exhale?
That's so special. You know, that was just a beautiful, serious, funny, poignant story. And we hadn't seen those characters and those stories and all those women together at the same moment in time. Because they didn't. It was as if women and black women couldn't carry a story, and we proved that we could.
Ahead of this year's Oscars, Angela Bassett has already proven she is Hollywood royalty.
Do you know what you're wearing? May I recommend that you wear purple? Because the color purple, it's a royal color.
Royalty, right?
Whatever you wear will be fine. But okay. Do you have something picked out?
Well, I haven't seen it yet. I haven't tried it on. I'm looking at sketches and trying to make decisions, and it's exciting. You know, you go to a lot of different events, and it hasn't been this difficult to pick a dress. You know, you fall in love, but it's something about this particular dress and evening that you want it to be, you know, beyond perfection.
And you know why we want it to be beyond perfection? Because we want this particular dress and this particular moment to live forever.
And ever, and ever, and ever, Wakanda ever. Forever.
Wakanda forever.
Wow.
We really do, Angela Bassett. So many people are pulling for you. I mean, God, she is such a lady. She is such a class act. She walks in the room and you know that something special has happened when you're in her presence. You know, also, you'll like this, Vlad, because she made history with the nomination. She's the first Marvel actress.
Yes.
To be I'm sure you already
know that. Yes, it's huge.
Let's go finish the sentence. First Marvel actress.
To be nominated for an Oscar.
Wow.
Normally it's special effects or something like that, but she's the first actress to be nominated.
In a superhero film, that's basically what we're saying.
That's another reason why it's such a big deal. She's been nominated for an Emmy 9 times, an Oscar twice, has never won. And she finds herself in the position that she was 29 years ago. She won the Golden Globe, and she didn't win the Oscar. That's how it goes sometimes. And so many people are pulling for Angela Bassett. They're hoping that this is her year. She's 64, number one. Let's just say that. I said to her makeup artist, what do you do to her cheekbones? Could you do that to me? No, Gail.
You're looking good, Gail. You look good.
But they're her cheekbones.
But
oh my God.
She's regal and charismatic. And from the moment that I was telling you, when I first saw her, the very first thing I ever saw her in when it premiered was Boys in the Hood, Reva Stiles. And I was like, who is this actress?
Yes.
Charismatic, beyond comprehension. And she only had a small role in that film.
But you remember her.
So much talent.
Absolutely.
So much talent.
That performance off the top, all these years
later. Oh, I know.
So
she just went into that. I wasn't expecting that.
it just shows
you she's
amazing.
She's damn good at what she does. Oscars March 12th. March.
Angelica Cox. I had the pleasure of speaking with Talik
Ibn Rushd, and, you know, he has a movement / ministry by the name of the Reality Temple on Earth. And I had the pleasure of speaking with him for several hours today, and I think it's only fair that I do a reaction video to the conversation. And the conversation was on various topics, which was basically centered around African, quote unquote, consciousness. And he was a real, real deep brother, very down to earth, very approachable. He didn't carry himself like a know-it-all. Someone you could talk to and really listen to you. It was such an honor to finally meet somebody over the internet that has a ear to listen, and not only an ear to listen, but will take full action on what they stand for. And I appreciate it having that conversation with you, and I do look forward to working with you.
Hello, YouTube. This is Tangelika the Black Sheep. I am welcoming you to join me on my new YouTube page, where I'll be discussing motivational of the Black Sheep.
Sherry, it's so good to see you. Thanks for dropping in. When you get a chance, look up Soul Liberation Day, December 7th. Oh, that's right around the corner, the transformation. Bless up. Bless up. Thank you for that. Let's see. Talik says, can you send a shout out to my platform, the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry. Our theme this year is After Purge Comes the Healing. Stuff. Shout out to your platform, Talik. All the best to you guys with continuing to stretch in perspective, to stretch in what is possible, and to continue to bring healing into the space of yourself and others. Yes.
Yes, I'd like to talk to you, take some of your precious time. I'd like to get to know you. Would you be so kind and do?
Tell me your secret wish and what is on your mind.
Tell me your secret wish.
Tell me your secret wish and I will tell.
If you don't.
Achoo.
Quiet! Keep it down up there! What did I just say? I'm calling the police! What did I just say? I'm calling the police! What did I just say? I'm calling the police!
Achoo.
Quiet! Keep it down up there! What did I just say? I'm calling the police!
Did you hear that? Did you hear them knocking on the ceiling? Insanity. The insanity that we have to put up in life. I will. It's crazy. In a process of healing.
I need your help, Terry.
Me?
What if Envo got back together to do a Christmas show to save the Opera House?
And when is this show supposed to go down?
Christmas Eve.
Christmas Eve?
Will the divas save the day? An In Vogue Christmas.
And as always, in parting, we wish you love, peace, and soul.